Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Before we begin, we would like to thank each one of you for helping us cross the 500,000 subscribers mark. And we expect your continued support so that we can deliver such high-value content which can be useful for civil service aspirants. So let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper, beginning with an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. 54 countries have backed India's bid for the non-permanent seat at the UN Security Council. The UN Security Council is one of the six principal organs of the United Nations, and it is considered to be the most powerful organ of the UN. If you look at the composition of the UNSC, it consists of five permanent members who are also referred to as the P5, and this includes the United States, the United Kingdom, France, Russia, and China. These five permanent members, they enjoy the veto power and they are assisted by 10 members in the non-permanent category. These non-permanent members, they are elected on a rotational basis for a term of 2 years. Unlike the permanent members, the non-permanent members do not enjoy the veto power, but they still play a very important role in enabling the functioning of the UN Security Council. Members to the non-permanent category are elected on a regional basis because there is a geographical quota which provides for adequate representation for different regions of the world. According to this geographical quota, there is one vacancy available for the Asia-Pacific group for the term 2021-22. And the election for this non-permanent seat, which will represent the Asia-Pacific region, will be held in 2020, and India's bid for this vacant seat has received unanimous support from all the members of the Asia-Pacific group. There are 55 members in the Asia-Pacific group, including India, and 54 countries have extended unanimous support to India's bid to contest the elections in 2020. These elections will be held at the UN General Assembly, and India would require two-thirds support at the UNGA to get elected to the vacant seat for the term 2021-22, during which India will get to represent the Asia-Pacific region as a non-permanent member at the UN Security Council. This development acquires a lot of significance because even India's arch rivals such as Pakistan and China have extended unanimous support to India for its bid to contest the 2020 elections. Previously, India has been elected as the non-permanent member of the Security Council for 7 times. And if India manages to get two-thirds support at the UN General Assembly in 2020, it will get to occupy the non-permanent seat at the Security Council for the 8th time. And the period for which India will be a non-permanent member holds a lot of diplomatic significance for the country, because 2022 marks the 75th anniversary of India's independence, and in the same year, India will also be hosting the G20 summit. So if India manages to occupy the non-permanent seat for this term, it can exercise further diplomatic leverage to boost India's standing at the international high table. So in this context, let us talk about the roles and responsibilities of the UN Security Council. The UNSC was established as the most powerful organ of the UN in a post-World War scenario in order to ensure international peace and security. This is the primary objective of the UNSC. And as a part of this mandate, the UN Security Council is involved in running peacekeeping operations. The UN peacekeeping forces function under the command of the UN Security Council. And the Security Council also has the powers to impose international sanctions such as economic sanctions and technological sanctions. These sanctions can be imposed against those countries which are seen to be disturbing international peace and security. And the UNSC also has the powers to authorize the use of military force against a target country. One such example would be the authorization given by the UNSC to invade Afghanistan after the 9/11 attacks and target the Taliban government for its role in sheltering the Al-Qaeda. And the UNSC is the only body of the United Nations which has the authority to issue binding resolutions to all the member states of the United Nations. The resolutions issued by the UNSC will be legally binding on all the 193 member states which are a part of the UN. And if any new member states have to be accepted to the United Nations, it has to be approved by the UN Security Council. And if any amendments have to be made to the UN Charter, then it has to be approved by the UN Security Council. Now let's take up the next article. US Secretary of State Mike Pompeo has met with India's Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar. This meet has acquired a lot of significance because it has provided an opportunity to resolve some of the outstanding differences between India and United States before Prime Minister Modi can meet with President Trump at the G20 summit, which is slated to be held in Japan this week. Some of the outstanding issues between India and US includes the demand of the United States that India should cancel the S-400 missile deal with Russia. It also includes the ongoing tensions between US and Iran and its impact on India's energy security and India's relations with Iran. And there are also a number of differences between India and US in the field of trade and commerce. Resolving these issues is considered to be the key to help India and US to continue their strategic and cordial relationship. During this interaction, India's foreign minister has said that India's relations with US has matured enough to negotiate and resolve these outstanding issues. The foreign minister has said that when two large countries are trading with each other, and if they are each other's biggest trading partners, then there are bound to be certain differences. They can be negotiated and resolved, considering the fact that India-US relationship has matured over the years. So with regard to the trade differences, let us look at some of the demands that have been raised by the United States. The US wants India to provide greater market access to American companies by reducing the tariff-based barriers. The US has also expressed concern about India's proposed law to regulate the e-commerce sector, because according to the US government and American companies, the proposed e-commerce law will create an unfair advantage for Indian e-commerce companies, and hence the US government is asking India to ensure a level playing field. Next, the US is also concerned about the Draft Data Protection Bill of India because it proposes to make data localization mandatory. If data localization is made mandatory, then any company which collects and stores the data of Indian citizens, it will be required to store this data within India's geographical borders. Because right now, most of the companies which are handling data, be it Facebook, Twitter, Google or Apple, they store the data collected from Indian citizens in offshore data centers. And this creates jurisdictional challenges for the Indian authorities and it can hamper investigation. That's the reason why the Draft Data Protection Bill has mandated data localization, and this has been resisted by American companies, and the US government has raised these concerns with the Indian government. And according to media reports, the GSP issue has not come up for discussion between India's foreign minister and the US Secretary of State. GSP stands for Generalized System of Preferences, which is a preferential trade mechanism provided by the United States to developing and underdeveloped countries. This system was introduced by the US through the Trade Act of 1974, and a list of developing and underdeveloped countries have been given the GSP status, and imports from these countries are provided a preferential treatment by the United States. The objective of the US was to help the developing and underdeveloped countries to help grow their economies. And until recently, even India enjoyed the GSP status, and as a result, Indian imports to the United States were receiving preferential treatment. But due to the trade differences which emerged between India and United States, the US government recently decided to withdraw the GSP status to India, and India has been looking to raise this issue with the US government. They have also discussed the ongoing tensions between US and Iran and its impact on India's energy security and India's strategic relations with Iran. As of now, India has zeroed out oil imports from Iran because of American pressure. Because the US refused to extend the exemption which had been granted for countries like India. And since the 2nd of May, India has been forced to zero out oil imports from Iran. And finally, with regard to the S-400 missile deal, India has clearly put its foot down. And it has said that it will proceed with a missile deal with Russia because procuring the S-400 is a part of India's national interest. The US has been trying to discourage India from acquiring the S-400 from Russia because Russia has been targeted with sanctions under the CATSA legislation of the United States. CATSA stands for Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. It is a legislation of the US Congress which has declared Russia, North Korea and Iran as adversary states to the United States. So under the legislation, these three countries have been targeted with economic sanctions. And it also imposes secondary sanctions against those countries which are trying to carry out trade in strategic areas with these countries. So the S-400 missile deal might invite sanctions against India as well under the CATSA legislation. But India has said that it will be defying US pressure and it will proceed to acquire S-400 from Russia because it is a core part of India's national interest. Next, we have an article on page 1 and 12, according to which 1 lakh more people have been excluded from the NRC list in Assam. NRC is an ongoing exercise in the state of Assam, which is looking to identify illegal migrants and foreigners. Last year, a draft NRC list was published according to the guidelines of the Supreme Court. And according to this draft list, out of 3.29 crore applicants, nearly 40 lakh people had been excluded. So essentially, those who have been excluded will be treated as illegal migrants or foreigners. And since it was a draft list, they have been given a second chance to file an appeal against their exclusion. Before the final NRC list is published by the 31st of July 2019, which is the deadline given by the Supreme Court. In the meantime, those who were already included in the draft NRC list, their names have been cross-checked. And based on this verification, more than 1 lakh people have been excluded from the draft NRC list. So this has increased the numbers of those who have been excluded from the draft NRC list. And this verification exercise has been carried out as per the guidelines of the Citizenship Act and the Citizenship Rules of 2003. Now let's take up an article from page number 9. The central government is all set to implement the Jal Shakti Abhiyan in the water-stressed districts of India. This ambitious initiative will focus mainly on rainwater harvesting and water conservation. It will also focus on renovation of water bodies, recharge of groundwater table, watershed development, and promoting afforestation. It is mainly focused on promoting rainwater harvesting and water conservation because the program is looking to enable the water-stressed districts to deal with the severe water crisis and provide for drinking water and irrigation. This program will be coordinated by central IAS officers who have been drawn from various ministries. And they are of the ranks of joint secretaries and additional secretaries. And they will be given the responsibility to monitor the implementation of the Jal Shakti Abhiyan. This model of implementation is very similar to the model of Gram Swaraj Abhiyan, which was implemented last year. Under the Gram Swaraj Abhiyan, central IAS officers were given the responsibility to monitor the implementation of the 7 flagship development schemes in the 117 aspirational districts of the country. The Jal Shakti Abhiyan will cover both aspirational and non-aspirational districts which are dealing with a severe water crisis, and it will be implemented in a time-bound manner and it will be executed in 2 phases. The first phase will be implemented between the 1st of July and the 15th of September, and it will focus on those states which will receive rainfall during the southwest monsoons. The second phase will be implemented between the 1st of October and the 30th of November, and it will cover those states which will receive rainfall during the retreating monsoons or the northeast monsoons. And the Jal Shakti Abhiyan will be synchronized with three other ongoing programs such as the Manrega program and the Integrated Watershed Management program, which is implemented by the Ministry of Rural Development. And it will also be synchronized with the restoration of water bodies that has been taken up by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. And under the Jal Shakti Abhiyan, the government will also carry out a massive outreach to the public by engaging various media and social media platforms in order to spread greater awareness about the Jal Shakti Abhiyan and the importance of rainwater harvesting and water conservation. Now let's take up a column from the editorial page, which has been written by Suhasini Haider. The column talks about the tough foreign policy choices that India has to make since it finds itself sandwiched between the United States on one side and Russia and China on the other side. The column has been written in the context of the upcoming G20 summit in Japan, wherein Prime Minister Modi will be having a number of high-level interactions with the global leaders. And on the sidelines of the G20 summit, India will be taking part in two high-profile interactions, which includes the RIC trilateral between Russia, India and China, and as well as the JAI summit, which includes Japan, United States and India. If you look at the major geopolitical developments across the world, it becomes very clear that two power blocks have emerged. One bloc led by the United States and the other led by the combination of Russia and China. So India finds itself sandwiched between the differing objectives of the United States and Russia and China. So in order to illustrate India's dilemma, the writer points out a number of instances, which includes the ongoing trade war between the United States and China, because the trade war between these two countries has had a spillover effect wherein the US has started to target India as well over their trade differences. So on this aspect, India clearly finds itself on the side of China, and it has been trying to resolve the trade differences with the United States. We have already discussed the S-400 missile deal, which has placed India in between US and Russia. This is again a dilemma for Indian diplomacy, and India has made it very clear that it will abide by its national interests and it will proceed with the S-400 missile deal. So this is likely to affect India's relations with the United States. Another instance which highlights India's dilemma would be the ongoing tensions between US and Iran. As we discussed earlier, India has been forced to zero out oil imports from Iran, even though Iran was a major supplier of crude oil. And this is likely to affect not only India's energy security, but as well as India's current account deficit. Because the oil that we were importing from Iran was one of the cheapest which is available in the global oil markets. But due to US pressure, India has been forced to cut off cheaper oil imports from Iran. And as a result, this is expected to increase India's current account deficit. Apart from this, tensions between US and Iran can also have an impact on the Chabahar port project that India has developed in Iran. India has made a lot of strategic investments in the Chabahar port with the idea of connecting with Afghanistan, Central Asian countries, and as well as with Russia through the North-South transport corridor. These ambitious connectivity projects can be affected because of American sanctions against Iran. Even though the Chabahar port has been excluded from the sanctions, shipping companies, banks and global corporations, they are hesitant to get involved in the Chabahar port project of India because of the fear of American sanctions which might affect their other businesses. So as a result, these strategic connectivity projects of India could be affected. And a similar dilemma can be seen with regard to the introduction of 5G network in India. With regard to 5G technology, the Chinese company Huawei is in a dominant position to introduce the technology across the world. But the United States has labeled Huawei as a major security threat. And it has directed all its close partners not to allow Huawei to set up the 5G technology in their countries. And if these countries were to allow Huawei to set up the 5G network, then the US has threatened to cut off all intelligence and security cooperation with these countries because of the cybersecurity threat posed by the telecom networks of Huawei. Through these instances, the writer highlights India's dilemma of being caught between the United States and Russia and China. And according to the writer, a way forward for India would be to establish a set of well-defined objectives which can guide its foreign policy. And these objectives should be focused on satisfying India's national interests or self-interests, and it should be insulated from the pressures exerted by various other countries. This is where the writer is asking the government of India to remember the true essence of the non-aligned movement that India had pioneered during the Cold War days. And the writer recalls a popular statement made by India's former Prime Minister P.V. Narasimha Rao. The former Prime Minister had said that standing on our own feet and not being a plaything of others was the essence of the policy of non-alignment. This was the core principle of the non-alignment strategy which was brought out by Pandit Nehru. And according to P.V. Narasimha Rao, India's principle of non-alignment was meant to safeguard India's national interests and promote the democratization of international relations. So keeping this in mind, the Indian government should come out with a set of well-defined objectives which can fulfill India's national interests, and it should be insulated from any sort of external pressure that could be exerted by the global powers. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following organizations are considered to be the principal organs of the UN? The correct answer is option D, because the UNGA, the UN Security Council, the UN Secretariat, the International Court of Justice, the Economic and Social Council, and the UN Trusteeship Council are the principal organs of the United Nations. Whereas UNDP is just a program of the UN. Now let's look at the second question. Which of the following flagship schemes were a part of the Gram Swaraj Abhiyan? The correct answer is option D, because the seven flagship schemes which were under the Gram Swaraj Abhiyan included the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, Saubhagya Scheme, Ujala Scheme, Pradhan Mantri Jandan Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti Bhima Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bhima Yojana, and Mission Indradhanush. Now let's look at the third question. Recently, data localization was mandated for payment system providers by the RBI. Option B is the correct answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following rivers are present along the US-Mexico border? The correct answer is option A, the Rio Grande River. Please look at the map. This is where the Rio Grande River is present. It flows along the US-Mexico border and it drains into the Gulf of Mexico. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. Which of the following practices can help in water conservation in agriculture? The correct answer is option D. All the three options can help in water conservation, because reduced tillage or zero tillage can retain soil moisture. The usage of gypsum can dissolve the salts and it will increase the percolation of water. And allowing crop residue in the field will reduce evaporation of water present in farm soil. So all the three can help in water conservation. So option D is the correct answer. Finally, let's take up a mains practice question. Today, I would be giving you an essay topic because we have discussed a number of articles which have described the challenges faced by Indian diplomacy. Please take down the essay topic. India's path to being a global power is peppered with challenges. So please try and write an answer to this question and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.